Good morning, church family.
Good morning.
The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with each one of you. It's so great to be back with you. I haven't been here in some time, and so it's wonderful to be here, to be worshiping with all of you. We have a lot to be thankful for. It is the seventh Sunday of Easter, meaning that we are 1 week away from Pentecost, which is amazing. Can't believe it's here already. And today we will celebrate and remember the ascension of our Lord. So a lot to be thankful for and a lot to worship for. But before we begin, are there any announcements for the church family? Yes?
On June 10th, I think everyone already knows we're having the fish fry. I have tickets to hand out. Please see me at church and get your tickets to sell. But on the ticket, when you sell them, you have a choice of fish fry or chicken. On your ticket, if it's a chicken, excuse me. That way we know how much it was.
Okay, so June 10th is the fish fry, but it's also a chicken fry.
Yes.
It's both. Okay. Great, thank you so much.
We had their fish and chicken yesterday. Claire and I were home in my own church, and same company did it there. That was great.
Wonderful. Okay, so it sounds like a wonderful repeat performance on June 10th. That's great. Other announcements for the church family? All right, then let's ready our hearts and our minds to worshiping God. And won't you join me in the bulletin? In the responsive call to worship. Open our hearts to your power,
moving around us and between us and within us,
until your glory is revealed in our love of both friend and enemy,
in communities transformed by justice and compassion,
and in the healing of all that is broken.
Amen.
Our first hymn this morning is hymn number 455, All Creatures of Our God and King.
Oh,
You know, it's so important for us to head back to God. Sin separates us, and so we have the opportunity to build that bridge back. And we build that bridge by confessing those sins. So please join me in the bulletin in the prayer of confession. We'll say this together. We need forgiveness, Lord, because we have not measured up to your expectations and not relied on your presence. Lord Jesus, forgive us and have mercy on us. Forgive our sadness and our sins. Forgive us for not living with each other the way you wanted. Lord, help us to live with each other and do your will. Help us to fulfill your mission for truth and goodness and show us everlasting life in your glory. Amen. Now let's take a moment for some silent confession. God is slow to anger and full of compassion, forgiving all of us who humbly repent and trust in Jesus as Savior and Lord. There is no condemnation for those of us who are in Christ Jesus.
We are forgiven through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let's share that peace with each other. Let us pray. Let your word guide us, O God, and may we hear what you would have us do today in our lives and in the world. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Our first reading this morning is taken from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1, verses 6 through 14. Hear the word of the Lord. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? He replied, it is not for you to know the times or the periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, and in Judea, and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood beside them. They said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey away. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying, Peter and John, and James, and Andrew, Philip, and Thomas, Bartholomew, and Matthew, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer, together with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second testimony this morning is from the Gospel of John,
chapter 17, verses 1 through 11. Hear the word of the Lord. After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up into heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that the Son may glorify you. Since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words that you gave me, I have given to them. And they have received them, and they know the truth, that I came from you. They have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you have given to me, because they are yours. All mine are yours. All yours are mine. And I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in this world, but they are still in the world. And I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given to me, so that they may be the ones and are the ones who will continue to give. This is the word of the Lord. And thanks be to God. Heaven on earth. We know this phrase, right? Something is heaven on earth. We almost don't need a definition to know about heaven on earth. You know things that are heaven on earth, yes? Could you share some of those heaven on earth experiences now? What for you has been heaven on earth?
Holding your grandchild.
Ah, yes, and I just held my brand new one. Yes, definitely heaven on earth.
Or great-grandchildren.
And the great ones, yes, absolutely. They're all great, right? Yes, that is heaven on earth. What else? What else is heaven on earth?
Sitting on a beach.
Ah, sitting on a beach. And are the waves lapping? And is the sand warm? Yes, heaven on earth. What else? What else is heaven on earth?
Gardening.
Yes, definitely gardening. I got my hands super dirty yesterday. We planted the community garden yesterday. There's definitely heaven on earth and dirt.
Music, a newborn baby.
Music, yes, holding a newborn baby, yes. All heaven on earth. Now, Webster's Dictionary would tell us that there's an official meaning for it. Here's your official meaning. It's a very pleasant or enjoyable place or situation. And you've just named many of those enjoyable things. I myself can't help but think of the lake in New Hampshire that I used to go to as a child and as a young adult, as a newly married person, and then bringing my own family there. And for me, what made it heaven on earth was the surroundings, the people who I was with, my family, and the peace and the joy that was just in all of that experience altogether. Now, there was a pop hit song in 1987 written by Linda Carlisle, and this tune was called Heaven on Earth. And so I want you to hear a couple of words from this. I won't sing them. That could be scary. Ooh, baby, do you know what that's worth? Ooh, baby, it's heaven on earth. Heaven is a place where love comes first. We'll make heaven a place on earth.
Pretty introspective, right, for the Pops music chart of 1987? Today we remember Jesus' ascension, which actually took place on the 39th day, which was last Tuesday. And it's interesting because John, in John's Gospel, he never talks about Jesus' ascension, and all the other Gospels and Acts talk about the actual ascension. Instead, today, we have John's account of Jesus praying aloud to his disciples. And this is the prayer that Jesus prays out loud just before his arrest. We get to hear about Jesus' hopes, and we get to hear the requests that he has of the Father. And we can listen in on his treatises as he speaks with God. And I just love that we have a ringside seat to this prayer. And like Caroline Lewis, author and professor from Luther Seminary, says, we don't look to this passage today to understand how to pray, what to pray, but we have Jesus praying. We have our Lord and Savior praying for the disciples and praying for us too. We get this amazing insight just listening in on what's important and what the focus is. So, what does this prayer tell us today that we can take away with us? First, it's not often that we get such a straightforward answer and definition to eternal life. But here it is. Listen to it again. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. How often have we heard about this eternal life definition? I'd have to say not often. Eternal life gets caught up in our images of heaven and how we will spend eternity, and it sort of spirals from there. Mark Twain said a dying man had to make a choice between going to heaven or going to hell. And both heaven and hell have their advantages, the dying man said. Heaven has good climate, and hell has all the company. But it's involved when we think about eternal life. It's involved when we think about heaven and how we will spend our time. But based on the definition that Jesus gives us today, eternity is simple. Jesus points out that eternal life is about knowing God and knowing Jesus and being in relationship with both of them right now. And right now, you may be saying, well, that's too simple and that's too elementary to understand eternal life that way. But that's what it's about. It's about understanding the power, the intimacy, the love that's in a relationship that comes when we have a relationship with God. And it's now. And to help us better understand, I was thinking about how all we need to do, we don't need to go any farther than the book of John. That gospel is so rich in relationship and what our relationship can be like with God, that I think it's right there for us. Look at the blind man and his life-changing event. He sees. He sees. He was blind, and now he sees. And he is not only physically seeing, but his life is also full and new and enriched through Jesus. He has a new purpose. He has acceptance. He understands. Listen for Lazarus as Jesus calls him out of death's tomb. One who was dead. Lazarus was dead. And now he is risen. Risen to sit and to eat with his sisters and to eat with Jesus himself.
Taste the water. The water that changes to rich and abundant wine, an overflow of love and possibility in a life with Christ. Smell the perfume that Mary pours on the Lord's feet and hear his words about everlasting life. Finally, read what Jesus tells us about a new commandment, loving each other as he loved us. Not just loving your neighbor as yourself, but loving as Jesus loved, with a deep sense of honor and sanctity for each other, and a deep caring for each other. I attended the funeral of a friend last week. It was someone who was much beloved by family and friends and all of us at work. The priest looked around the church and said to us, "You have packed this church for Manny. The church is at overflow because you love him. And he loved you with his smile, with his kindnesses, with his random acts of love every day, in and out." And the priest went on to say that if we wanted to pay tribute to Manny, we should definitely take out his pictures, we should look at videos, we should read what Manny wrote to us. But if we really wanted to pay tribute to the man, we should give someone a smile. We should do a kindness for someone we don't know. We should feed someone who needs to eat. We should do random things for strangers who we love. That will be a tribute to Manny. To love as Manny loved. To love each other the way Jesus wants us to love. And so this eternal life, it's right here and right now. It is experiencing the love of our Savior, seeing it for ourselves, living in that relationship with God, and loving each other the way he loved us, right now. He does this, how does this change our thoughts about a future life with God, about eternal life? I think it can change it radically. How does this approach change your own ideas about heaven on earth? Jesus closes his prayer with the following thoughts. "And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them so that they may be one as we are one." What a wonderful blessing. Heaven on earth is one with God, the God that loves us. And we are still in this world, in a world that needs our witness and our love. Ooh, baby, heaven is a place on earth. They say in heaven, love comes first. Let's make heaven a place on earth. Amen.
Amen.
At this time, let's stand and affirm our faith with the Apostles' Creed, which I believe is on page 14 in your hymnal.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And while we stand, let's sing our second hymn.
Number 368, I've got peace like a river. Let's go to God in prayer. Almighty God, we come today reminded of your greatness and your glory and your eternal purpose, all expressed in Jesus our Lord. We thank you for the wonder of ascension, that marvelous yet mysterious moment in the lives of the apostles, when they were left gazing heavenwards in confusion, but departing in joy. We thank you for the way that it brought the earthly ministry of Jesus to a conclusion that all points to his oneness with you. We thank you that through the ascension, Jesus is now set free to be Lord of all, no bounds. Nothing holds him back. He's able to reach even to the ends of the earth. We thank you that through his departing, Jesus prepared for his coming again through his Spirit, his church. Lord, we thank you for the joys in our lives. We thank you for the love of family and friends, for this church family, for new life and lives well lived. We thank you that Shirley is here, God bless her. And we're so thankful that Rocco is here too, on the scene. We ask you also to be near us as we deal with the sorrows of this life, the heartache of loss, medical, mental, and physical issues that we live through day in and day out. Be nearer to us through these valleys of our lives, Lord. Please be with Judy as she receives tests. Be with the families of Wayne Russell in his untimely passing. Be with Angie. And also be with Aunt Phil as she works through rehab. Help us to remember the eternal life you offer to all of us as we live every day, growing closer to you, growing into a deeper relationship with you. Help us to remember and understand the wonder of your ascension, to live in the fullness of your revelation. Help us to live with a deeper sense of wonder, a stronger faith, and a greater understanding of all you have done for us. We pray this all in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now, I would like to invite us all to remember this church family with our tithes, our time, and our offerings. At this time, we will take our offering. God of all, we give back in grateful thanksgiving for all you have already given us. In the upside-down world of the gospel, we measure our wealth not by what we have, but by what we can give away. How we can give away our gospel. Help us to give away generously in this offering, to bless your church, your people, and your creation. Amen. And now please join me in the final hymn, called as Partners in Christ's Service, it's number 343.
Thank you.
benediction. Be my witnesses to the ends of the earth, says the Lord. Know that I am with you always, till the end of time. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each one of us now and forever. Amen.
Amen.